yard, easy to do. We've got one in our yard. And we'd also be happy to bring a sign to your house if you would like for us to do that for you. We're once again going to be sending invitations to our Christmas Eve service. And they look like that. If you'd like an invitation sent to someone who's not normally on our mailing list, we would welcome them to the service. Please contact Sherry with a name and address, and she'll make sure that person gets an invitation. And there's some invitations in the narthex if you'd like to take one. I would also like to announce that the men's monthly brunch is going to occur on Thursday, December 23rd at Julie's. And we've had this is the third one, actually, and we've had a couple of good brunches, enjoyable. We'd really like for anybody, actually, as Pastor Mark pointed out to me, we will also welcome women to this breakfast if they'd like to come. I don't know why they want to come to a bunch of men talking football, but if they would, we'd love to have them. It would certainly brighten up the breakfast. And we would like to see you at 9 o'clock Thursday, December 23rd at Julie's. And finally, I would like to point out that in your bulletin, there's a special offering envelope. I had it here, but I lost it. And it's for a Christmas fund for the veterans of the cross and the emergency fund. So if you feel so inclined, you can use it and put an offering in it and put it in the offering box in the narthex. And now we have the lighting of the Advent candle. Rebecca Fenn.
Good morning. Love. Everything begins with love. From the beginning of creation to the end of time, God's love colors everything. Open your hearts to love, and you will recognize hope shining in the most ancient of promises. Love. Everything continues with love. From strangers across oceans to neighbors next door, God's love dwells in everything. Live love as a way of being, and you will see peace shining in each and every face that images beloved. Love. Everything ends with love. From the most challenging struggle to the most wondrous delight, God's love flows through everything. Give love with open hands, and you will find joy shining in the surprises that undo us and transform us. Love. Everyone leans toward love. From the greatest ruler to the tiniest baby, God's love changes everything. Prepare the way for love, and you will find love shining in each and every breath that whispers, Emmanuel.
Okay, if we now stand and sing hymn 290, As With Gladness, Men of Old. Okay, now, oh, you may be seated. We'll now read the call to worship. It's in your bulletin. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior.
With Mary, our spirits rejoice, and we sing God's praise.
Let us honor God with our worship this fourth Sunday of Advent.
Let us pray. O God, you broke down the barriers when you crept in beside us. In Jesus, your hands touched all and touched us. You opened our eyes to see how the hands of the rich were empty and the hearts of the poor were full. You took the widow's mite and the child's loaves and used them to show us the kingdom of God. Here in the company of the neighbor whom we know and the stranger in our midst, and the self from whom we turn, we ask to love as Jesus loved. Make this the place and time, good Lord, when heaven and earth become one, and we in word and flesh know ourselves beloved. In Jesus' name, amen.
God promises forgiveness through Jesus Christ. On this fourth Sunday of Advent, let us approach God in humility and faith. And let us worship God with the prayer of confession. Soon we will celebrate the Prince of Peace. We dominate and demean in our conversations and relationships. We wage war with our enemies and invest in self-defense without careful regard of the consequences or exhausting nonviolent strategies. Lord, forgive us. Help us work towards your peaceable kingdom where swords will be beaten into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks. And now for the assurance of grace. And he will stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, and they shall live secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen. Would the young people and those young at heart like to come forward and join me? Good morning, Maxwell. How are you today? Yeah, very vocal. Lots to say. Good morning. I brought something with me this morning to tell a wonderful story. See that? See that? Yeah. I stole that from my Christmas tree this morning. I hope my wife doesn't notice. It is a little angel. Now, little angels like this are often called cherubs. Cherubs, yeah? Okay. Little cherubs. I'll set that right there. Well, the story I want to tell you today is, first of all, thinking about the way we think about other people. A lot of times we think that certain people, like we call them VIPs, are real special. And they are in a certain way. But then we think about other people as not being so special. We judge people by the way we look or by the job they have or how much education they have. But in God's eyes, everyone is special. Now our story, many years ago, there was a young woman. And this young woman, she wasn't very special at all. I mean, she was, she lived at home and she didn't have a good job. And boy, back in those times, women just weren't very highly respected at all. So to most people, she wasn't very special. She wasn't very important. But she was important to God. Do you know what that woman's name was? I have a picture here with an angel. Who do you think the woman is? Oh, come on. Mary, of course, it's Mary. Do you know who the angel was? That's a little harder. Anyone tell me who the angel was that visited Mary? Gabriel, that's Gabriel. And he came to tell Mary that to God, she was a very, very special person, even though the people around her probably didn't think she was all that special. God knew that she was very special. And you know what God asked her to do? To be the mother of Jesus. And she was surprised. She said, "Who, me? I'm nobody special." And Gabriel said, "You are special." Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you're special too. You thought that was funny. So, God thinks that all of his children are special. It doesn't matter how much money you make. It doesn't matter what kind of a job you have. It just matters that you are a child of God, and God loves you. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for making us all important in your eyes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, at this time, I'm going to speak the prayer for illumination. Open us, Holy One, to your word and your way. Clear our minds of holiday distractions and busy tasks. Fill our hearts with the humility we need to hear and receive the message you intend for us today. Amen. And now, if you would like, you can open your Bibles as we read from Scripture. First Scripture reading is from the Old Testament book of Micah, chapter 5, verses 2 through 5a. I honestly didn't know there were A's and B's in the verses in the Bible. That's interesting. "But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace." Our second scripture reading is from the New Testament book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 38. "In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, 'Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you.' Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end.' 'How will this be?' Mary asked the angel, 'since I am a virgin.' The angel answered, 'The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word to me be fulfilled. Then the angel left her. This is the word of the Lord.
Take me back to 8 years old, the little church on a dead-end road, with a candle flicker in one hand and Dad's hand in the other. Take me back to silent night, my heart was full and the world was right, 'cause right now the world looks nothing like those innocent Decembers. These days peace on earth is hard to find, and I need you to remind me one more time. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. Watch the snowflakes falling down like a blanket on this town. For a moment we can hardly see the pain this year has brought us. May the sick find healing's touch, may hatred's fight be won with love, and may every heart make room for you, the one who came to save us. 'Cause you're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. Bowed my head to pray tonight, felt my little girl by my side. She slipped her tiny hand in mine, and we both talked to you. And it took me back to 8 years old, my daddy's hand and a story told about heaven's love in the manger low, and a promise that's still true. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. Still the hope of Christmas. You're still the hope of my heart.
During this Advent season, we are exploring what it means to live faithfully as we prepare to celebrate the birth of Jesus and to await the return of Christ our Savior. Today we examine Mary's call and what it says to us about God's relationship with humanity. I don't know about you, but When I pray, I sometimes wish that I could get a clear word from God. Wouldn't it be great if life was uncomplicated? If life was served to us in ways we could clearly understand? But that isn't the case for most things with God. God's ways are unpredictable. They might be subtle, or they might be startling, especially if we believe that God only acts in predictable ways. As we deal with our gospel reading this morning, we certainly see that God's encounter with the young Mary through the angel Gabriel, shocking and profound in ways that most of us couldn't imagine. She is told by Gabriel that she has been chosen by God to give birth to the Savior of the world. Oh, the angel Gabriel, shocking and profound. Probably not the news she was expecting when she got up that morning. God's call to Mary offers us some interesting insight into God's priorities and God's connection with humanity. It shows us how God acted in Mary's day and offers us a view of perhaps how God works with us today. One of the greatest struggles I have being a pastor is the constant feeling that I'm not worthy. I've been called a reverend, pastor, preacher, man of the cloth, and my Catholic mother often called me my son the priest. As one who has never had real strong self-esteem, that's a lot to live up to. Sometimes when people come to me for counseling because they see me as someone who has a special connection with God, I think to myself, what if they find out I'm just a regular person, just like everyone else? Then I remember the old saying, God doesn't call the qualified, God qualifies the called. And I pray that God will keep qualifying me. The scripture tells us that Mary was from a modest background. There was nothing special about her other than her love for God. Who would have expected that the Savior of the world would be born to such a one? The Jews awaiting the coming of the Messiah would probably have been more accepting of Jesus if he had been born to highly educated religious leaders, or even in the house of royalty. It would have made more sense to the Jews during Jesus' lifetime, and if we're honest with ourselves, it would have made more sense to us as well. We also have to remember that although the Jews believed that the Messiah would be one sent from God and ordained by God, the idea that the Messiah would be the Son of God, or even God in the flesh, was not a common belief, if it was considered at all. The Messiah should have been born into a family where he would have received the best of everything, a nanny for his everyday care, a rabbi for personal one-on-one tutoring, the freedom to not have to work, but to spend all day in his study, studying the scrolls and meditating on God. The idea that the Messiah would be born to a working-class family from the unremarkable little village of Nazareth was inconceivable. But God had different plans. How often do we focus on outward things? I read an article once that suggested the rudest question we could ask someone we have just met is, "What do you do for a living?" Why is it rude? The rudeness comes from how we might respond to the answer. If the person says, "I'm a cardiac surgeon," we're impressed and we engage in meaningful conversation. But what if someone answers, "I bus tables at the truck stop down by the interstate"? Might we have a different response to this person than we would to the surgeon? Do we judge the worthiness of an individual based solely on what they do for a living? God doesn't. God sees beyond what we do to who we are. God saw the potential in Mary. and chose her for perhaps the most important role any human being has ever fulfilled. We normally think of someone being favored because they have a special position in life. VIPs, we call them. Now, these people used to be people like Nobel Prize winners, government dignitaries from countries around the world, CEOs of major corporations. Power, influence, or money define their worth. Nowadays, VIPs seem to be people like pop singers, movie stars, professional sports figures, although how they qualify as VIPs is beyond me. However, in our story of God's call of Mary, Gabriel begins his message with, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." Not many of us are used to being greeted with these words. Luke tells us that she was much perplexed by Gabriel's words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. What sort of greeting indeed? Gabriel continues with, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God." Favor with God. Now, I know God doesn't make mistakes, but maybe Gabriel's confused. Mary was a Jewish girl from a modest family. As a child and a female, her worth and status in Jewish society hovered just slightly above that of a Gentile. Who was she to be considered special in the eyes of the living God? The Bible certainly never tells us why she was chosen, any more than it tells us why we are chosen. God's grace is bestowed upon us not because we have earned it, but because our God is a gracious God. It is a gift from God. God's grace is central to our faith. We know that when we fail, God still loves us. It gives us the hope to go on. It gives us the strength to try again. God knows us through and through, our weaknesses, our faults, and our failures, our prejudices. But God is eager, in spite of what God knows about us, to love us. God chose to grace Mary with this task, just as God graces all who are called to serve. God could have come into the world in any form. Why was a vulnerable baby chosen? Not only that, but why did God choose someone as vulnerable as Mary to conceive and nurture the Savior of the world at the risk of her own reputation and even her life? Jewish law specified that a woman who was not found to be a virgin before betrothal could be stoned to death. If a betrothed woman were to sleep with another man, the law specified that both should be stoned to death. When Mary said, "Here am I, a servant of the Lord, let it be with me according to your word," she risked everything. Her trust in God was far greater than her fear of the consequences of her decision. If in fact she ever even considered the consequences at all. Her joy in serving God was so great that she praised God in song, recounting God's goodness to her and God's faithfulness to God's chosen people. Just how vulnerable are we willing to be in our desire to honor and obey God? How willing are we to face rejection, ridicule, or criticism for our faith? How willing are we to put our faith on the line? What cost are we willing to pay for our belief in Jesus Christ? So often we ask ourselves the question, what do I want? What would make me happy? This past week I posted the following quote by Ralph Waldo Emerson on my Facebook page. "The purpose of life is not to be happy. It is to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, and to have it make some difference that you have lived." and lived well. For many of us, if we were to accomplish such a life, I'm sure it would bring us great joy, the joy which Mary felt in her response to God's call. The question we really need to ask ourselves daily is, what do you want, O God? What would please you? How do you want me to honor you? These may be questions that are new to you, but if we lived faithfully, they are questions that will help us usher in the kingdom of God right here in our own community and within our own congregation. Although we sometimes wonder about God's ways, we are always in awe of God's greatness. We are so used to living by the standards of this world that we sometimes are uncomfortable at the request that God makes of us. Yet God continues to call us. God seeks us out and reveals to us that there is a better way to live. God challenges us to embrace Christ's truth. We need to learn to embrace the strength that comes to us when we are vulnerable before God. We need to learn to welcome and accept God's grace. Then we will be able to live lives of humble service, always grateful for God's abundant blessings to us. Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word, O God. Amen.
Yeah.
amor, todos duermen alrededor. Sobre el santo niño Jesús. Esparce su luz, brilla sobre el rey, brilla sobre el
And now we have a special recognition from the Women's Guild.
Good morning. My name's Debbie Mangum. If you don't know me, I'm the president of the Women's Guild here at the church. On behalf of the Women's Guild today, we'd like to present this plaque to Dorothy Dot Kessner in appreciation for the many years of service of the Women's Guild here at EUCC. You've done a lot of work here, service, dedication, and I think you still are helping a lot. Got a lot of years to help with this yet.
Congratulations, Dot. Let us now go to God in prayer. Come, O come, Emmanuel. Come to bring peace to those at war with themselves, their families, their enemies. May those who govern do so with goodwill and justice, breaking down barriers, fostering understanding, and drawing our communities and our nations together in peace. Come, O come, Emmanuel. Come to bring comfort to those in pain, those who grieve, those in need of healing and restoration. May those who suffer be assured of your extravagant grace and comforted by the hope that nothing shall separate them from your love. Come, O come, Emmanuel. Come to bring compassion to those who are weak and weary, those who stumble through their days unable to recognize the beauty and meaning of life. May those who are unemployed, those who are struggling financially, those suffering under the crushing weight of debt, find your way out of no way. Grant them options, God. Grant them hope. Come, O key of David, O radiant dawn, O root of Jesse, O Emmanuel, come to us again this Christmas. Fill the world with your grace and peace. Finally, hear us now as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In this season of generosity, let us remember from whom our blessings flow. Let us present our offerings to the Lord. The offering box is in the narthex. If you were unable to place your offering in the box as you entered, you may do so as you exit. Let us thank God. Holy God, with Mary, we seek to magnify you in our worship and in our deeds. Accept our gifts and bless them for Christ's ministry. May they lift the lowly and fill the hungry. May they reveal your glory present with us today and still yet to come. Through Christ we pray. Amen. And our final hymn is Angels We Have Heard on High, number 278. I invite you to stand and let us join our voices together. May starlight guide your steps toward this place of wonder. May angels sing their news as you travel to the manger. May hope and promise fill these days as we watch for the miraculous to enter our lives. And may faith tell you, Emmanuel will be with us soon. A reminder, I don't know that you really need one, but this Friday evening happens to be Christmas Eve, and we will be having a Christmas Eve service here at 7 o'clock p.m. We hope you and your friends and family can all come and join us for that celebration. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.